prepare our hearts and minds for worship as we light our Christ candle. And as we gather and worship this day, we think of a most unforgettable day. The hardest day of the year, the longest day of the year, the scariest day of the year, the loudest, quietest, darkest, brightest, the bravest day of the year. Remembrance Day. The most unforgettable day of the year. We light our Christ candle knowing that Christ's Spirit can guide us through all of the difficult days of our lives. Let us join in our choral gathering. Take, O take me as I am.
Oh,
center ourselves in our time of worship by offering our opening prayer. Let us pray. God, we know you take no joy in death. We know you take no joy in our wars, in our battles, in our conflicts. We know that you have tears for all your children, of every land and race, of every time and place. We know that what you want for all creation is life, abundant life. And so we ask for your wisdom. We pray for your guidance. We pray for your peace, your shalom, your salam. We ask for your hands to guide your creation, for your love to sustain your creation, for your grace to surround your creation now and forever. May your spirit surround all that we do on this day, especially in our remembrance in worship. Amen. We join now in our time of remembrance, and for the reading of the names from our honor roll, and I will invite you to stand, and as you are able. And we'll open our service by singing, O God, our help in ages past, verses 1, 2, and 3.
C.J. Bemish, H. Robinson,
L. Robinson, B. S. Scott, V. N. Scriber, E. Shepherd, J. Stewart, W. Simpson, W. H. Warner, W. E. Washburn, L. R. Fleming, G. A. Metcalf, R. H. Scriber, A. M. Venters, Marie Ryder, L. W. Brownell, E. M. Brown, J. H. Fairman. They shall grow not old as we that are left grow old. Age shall not weary them, nor the years condemn. At the going down of the sun and in the morning, we will remember them.
We will remember them.
I invite you to be seated. We'll offer our prayer litany for Remembrance Day with the praying of the Holy Spirit. Let us pray. Loving God, our ancestors fought to keep us free, yet there are those who would take this freedom from us. Today we remember all those who have served in our country's armed forces to preserve that freedom, for the men and women who served and are serving in the Air Force, Army, Navy, and in other capacities. We ask your blessings. For the family members who made great sacrifices in order to make it possible for their service members to be on watch at home or around the world, or to go into harm's way, we ask your blessings. For the families who grieve the death of a member who went in harm's way, never to return, we ask your blessings. Jesus tells us that no one has greater love than to lay down one's life for one's friends. For all those veterans who have laid down their lives for us, we ask your blessings. For the veterans of past wars who bear scars in their bodies and spirits, for veterans who came home but couldn't fit in with their families or communities anymore, we ask your blessings. Keep all our veterans in your care today. Grant them the peace they sought to preserve for others. Teach all your people the ways of peace, for those who have sacrificed so much for peace and freedom will not have done so in vain. We pray all these things in the name of our Lord and Savior. Amen. Let us join in the verses 4, 5, and 6 of O God, our help in ages past.
Thank you.
Our scripture reading for today is from the book of Prophet Joshua, chapter 3, verses 7 to 17. The Lord said to Joshua, "This day I will begin to exalt you in the sight of all Israel, so that they may know that I will be with you as I was with Moses. You are the one who shall command the priests who bear the Ark of the Covenant. When you come to the edge of the waters of the Jordan, you shall stand still in the Jordan." Joshua then said to the Israelites, "Draw near and hear the words of the Lord your God." Joshua said, "By this you shall know that among you is a living God, who without fail will drive out from before you the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Hivites, the Perizzites, the Girgashites, the Amorites, and the Jebusites. The Ark of the Covenant of the Lord of all the earth is going to pass before you into the Jordan. So now, select 12 men from the tribes of Israel, one from each tribe. When the soles of the feet of the priests who bear the Ark of the Lord of all the earth, rest in the waters of the Jordan, the waters of the Jordan flowing from above shall be cut off. They shall stand in a single heap. When the people set out from their tents to cross over the Jordan, the priests bearing the Ark of the Covenant were in the front of the people. Now the Jordan overflows all its banks throughout the time of harvest. So when those who bore the Ark had come to the Jordan, and the feet of the priests bearing the Ark were dipped in the edge of the waters flowing from above stood still, rising in a single heap far off at Adam, the city that is beside Zarethan, while those flowing toward the Sea of Arabah, the Dead Sea, were wholly cut off. Then the people crossed over opposite Jericho. While all Israel were crossing over on dry ground, the priests who bore the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord stood on dry ground in the middle of the Jordan until the entire nation finished crossing over the Jordan." And this reading is good news for God's people. May the Spirit of the living God be with us today. Amen. A few words around fearful and anxious time. Loving, gracious God, may what is said and heard be in the spirit of you, our living God. Amen. It would not be surprising to think that a new young leader like Joshua would feel anxious or inadequate. Happens to all new young leaders. Joshua is taking over the reins of leadership from the great and incomparable Moses, who led Israel faithfully for 40 years through the wilderness. First across the Red Sea and then through the wilderness. As it says in the book of Deuteronomy, Moses was unequaled for all the mighty deeds and all the terrifying displays of power that Moses performed in the sight of Israel. A tough act to follow. The second reason for Joshua to feel maybe a little fearful and anxious is the Canaanite enemy he's about to encounter. An earlier spy mission into Canaan had revealed that the people who lived in the land are strong, and the towns are fortified and very large, right, according to the book of Numbers. So a tough enemy to face. Joshua needed repeated words of encouragement and support. Before his death, Moses had encouraged Joshua, said, "Be strong and bold. It's the Lord who goes before you. He will be with you. He will not fail or forsake you. Do not fear or be dismayed." Also from the book of Deuteronomy. God also repeatedly reassured Joshua once he became Israel's leader. "As I was with Moses, so I will be with you. I will not fail or forsake you." And again, "Be strong and courageous. Do not be frightened or dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go." That's from today's reading. And a third time, "I will begin to exalt you, so that you may know that I will be with you as I was with Moses." God will keep repeating reassurance. Do not fear. Do not fear. I will be with you. That negative command, do not fear, and the positive command, be strong and bold, recur often through the pages of Scripture. When God calls a leader or a community to a new mission, fear eventually gives way to confidence and hope. Of course, we could judge that it's true that, as the Proverbs say, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Proverbs 9. But fearing and trusting in the Lord means not being afraid of forces that resist God, even when the obstacles seem impossible to us. Not being afraid is only possible because of the promise that God will be with us. Faithfully fulfilling God's call in our lives is not, first of all, rooted in our own estimates of our human abilities and our human resources. Success depends on whether we consider that our God is with us or against us. Through Scripture, God proclaims to God's people, do not fear, I will be with you. And the list is long. The list is long of those who needed that assurance through God's word, beginning with Abraham, Hagar, Jacob, Moses, the judge Gideon, the book of Judges, King Hezekiah, the psalmist, Jeremiah, Daniel, Mary, shepherds who were summoned by angels, disciples who got caught in a storm, frightened disciples at the night of Jesus' betrayal, disciples frightened by reports of a resurrected Jesus. We have in Matthew 28. The Apostle Paul, throughout all of his time, journeying and proclaiming the Lord Jesus Christ as his Savior. And then into the end, John of Patmos, in the book of Revelation. We hear these words. When I saw him, I fell at his feet as though dead. But he placed his right hand on me, saying, do not be afraid. I am the first and the last, and the living one. I was dead, and see, I am alive forever and ever. And I have the keys of death and of Hades. So you've got this large cloud of witnesses who testify that following God's call into a new venture, sometimes a difficult venture, sometimes a scary venture, can stir up fear in your heart. Yet the repeated promises of God urge us to let go of that debilitating fear. I will be with you, he says. Trust God. Let go of whatever overwhelming anxieties and worries paralyze us into retreat, inaction, or overreaction. The events of Joshua 3 have a ritual and sort of sacramental quality to them, the text for today. It combines the spoken command of not being afraid, a spoken promise of being with you, and this material physical sign that brings an identifying, defining event to remembrance and interpretation for future generations. Joshua promises that the Lord will do wonders among you, and that wonder will involve all Israel somehow crossing these raging floodwaters of the Jordan River. And then at the center of this river crossing, the priestly tribe of Levites, they're carrying the Ark of the Covenant in this sort of liturgical procession. And the Ark was a holy container that held the stone tablets of the Ten Commandments. The Ark was also a material sign of God's living presence in the midst of the people of Israel. And as such, the Ark sort of radiated with this holy and dangerous power. And any unauthorized person, non-priest, who came too close or touched the Ark would die. So it was sort of a holy, dangerous power to it. So the people are instructed to give the Ark some space. a distance of 2,000 cubits, actually, which was about two-thirds of a mile. So that's a fair bit of space. And the Lord's great wonder is about to happen. The toes of the priest touch the water, the edge of these swollen rivers, and the river abruptly stops flowing. Jordan water is piled up in a heap. Dry land suddenly appears across the bed of the river, and the priest solemnly processes across into the middle of the riverbed with the ark. And what's the significance of this event? Well, the crossing of the Jordan River points back to the time of Moses and Israelites' dramatic crossing through the parted waters of the Red Sea. And crossing the Red Sea involved fear and risk, but it led to freedom. So these two water crossings, the Red Sea and Jordan River, formed bookends to Israel's journey from slavery to freedom, from death to life. What's also interesting, in the next chapter, Joshua completes this liturgical procession of crossing the river, the Jordan River, by commanding that two piles of 12 large stones, one for each of the 12 tribes of Israel, be erected. One mound of stones was set up at the river water's edge, and the other in the middle of the Jordan River, as a memorial forever, it says in Joshua 4. Piles of stones are physical and material memorials, imbued with this deep mythic kind of meaning, memories, and resonances over time. They sparkle with promises. I will be with you. The rock rings with this call to freedom rather than to slavery, to life rather than death, to hope rather than despair. And they yearn for a preacher to lift up their voices again, to proclaim the wonders of the Lord for a new day. And doesn't this speak out boldly, this whole reading speak out boldly to the time of year that we are at this time? Remembrance Day. And I have no doubt in my mind that the leaders of countries at the time of war were filled with anxiousness and fear. Just like Joshua, they were called to serve the people, to care and direct and look after them. And the right leader, the strong leader, could make a big difference in how the people reacted to any impending threat. Leadership was important in Joshua's time. It's important in our time, too. And we hear the words of Vladimir Zelensky. I mean, there's a leader that's would remind you of Joshua. Words that are supportive of his people and giving them that hope into the future. Each day in, day out, he's almost on television reports every day. And when the victory has been won, then there would be some sort of monumental remembrance laid out to mark the place and the time where that victory took place. And also to mark where those who did not survive the battle will be remembered. Our cenotaphs are our remembrance stones to this very day. And give us a place to center our acts of prayer and remembrance. And to this very day, we look to our leaders in our countries, but even more so for many of us, we look to our God to help us through with words of encouragement that are peppered throughout Scripture. Do not worry, I will be with you. And when those words come to us, then our fearful and anxious nature can take up its residence and be held in the safety of God's embracing arms. I remember quite well when my pipe band would play at Remembrance Day in Port Hope, and then in the afternoon we would go to Canton, the village just up the road, and they were creating their own cenotaph each year all the people who were gathered there would, they had a pile of rocks there, and they would actually process through after, either before or after the service, pick up one of these rocks, and they were laying them on a pile of rocks. So it became like a huge cairn, and that was their cenotaph. I'll never forget that. Now I was reminded of it when I read the story in Joshua. We're piling up the stones that are remembrances for generations to come. So to Jesus, the Christ who knew us and loved us before we were, who loves us now and will love us forever, thanks be to God. Amen. Now I forgot to put in the minute for mission last week, so I put it in for this week. Falling in love with earth. Typed it wrong. An awakening. That's how Sarah Arthur describes what she experienced just before she came up with the idea for Green Exodus. Gatherings of people who find themselves falling deeply in love with earth and want to help it flourish. Back in 2008, partly due to the influence of former moderator, the very Reverend Bill Phipps, who just passed away last year, my family and I moved into Prairie Sky Co-Housing Cooperative to maintain a smaller footprint on the earth, explains Arthur. She figured that with that, she had done her part. With the move, it was as if I said to the earth, "Don't call me, I'll call you," she says. Then in 2019, she reads articles in the Tai E magazine by William Reese, originator of the carbon footprint model. He described how technology was not going to save us from the destruction of climate change, and it was as if the earth came calling. "I was left with new awareness and big questions," she says. Those questions evolved into the idea of Green Exodus gatherings. With the help from an Embracing the Spirit grant supported through your mission and service gifts, the support of Edge Network and an advisory team, Green Exodus meetings were born. Throughout the pandemic, the group met online to explore the spiritual questions raised by climate change and the theologies and spiritual practices that were emerging as a result. We used various practices to realign our relationship with Earth, things like meditation, poetry, contemplative photography, deep time walk, community conversations, and hospitality, she says, adding, "Tony Snow guided us in attention to land acknowledgement and the four elements of fire, air, water, and earth as a way to ground ourselves in the earth." Some of the practices used are highlighted on the website greenexodus.ca. A key probing question runs through all of them. How can we be good soil for the love of our earth? How can we be good soil for the love of our earth? You can only see as sacred what you love. You can only save what you love. We need to practice falling in love with earth again, she says. Your gifts through mission and service support unique, transformative ministries like Green Exodus. Thank you for your generosity. And let us join together in our offertory with Kennedy.
Thank you.
hostility and intolerance are the kindling for conflict. Gracious God, through our offerings, address injustice, encourage dialogue, fill minds and stomachs, to put out the embers before they become the fertile fires of war. Amen. Please be seated. Let us all unite in prayer. Let us pray. Your Spirit, God, is a different Spirit. Your peace is a different peace. You cross to a destination that leaves behind hurt and wrong. For it's from another world that these gifts come. From another way of existence they come to touch our aching hearts and hurting bodies. Come, God, come to strengthen us and to quietly and gently give our lives a different rule. A rule that comes from a different place where beauty and truth and caring make up life. Where wealth is in community, friendship, and respect. The world is so very hurtful, violent, and abrasive, God. Still, your Spirit keeps coming and coming. Still, your Spirit keeps touching us and keeps healing us in this world of ours. Your Spirit keeps teaching and urging and showing your love. All can seem so wrong and painful, and still your Spirit comes with another way, a freedom from all that oppresses our world and us. Freedom that gives us the strength to persevere. So as we come before you in prayer this day, God, we think of our community members, those who are ill of mind, body, or spirit, those who may be in care facility, those who may be mourning the loss of life within their midst. May your healing touch surround them, care for them, sustain them. May they know how much they are loved and cared for. In the spirit of remembrance, we gather these our prayers this day and bring them to the words that Jesus taught us to pray as we say together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And let us join in our closing hymn, Make Me a Channel of Your Peace, from Voices United, number 684.
Thank you.
responsive commissioning is printed in your bulletin. As we go from here today, we know that God speaks. In the midst of turmoil, peace. In the midst of tough decision-making, peace. In the midst of family conflicts, peace. In the midst of friendships, challenges, peace. When apathy is overcome, peace. When the just cause is persistently pursued, peace. Peace when peace seems to be the impossible dream. God speaks and we live the way of peace that Jesus taught and lived. And as we go from here this day, may the love of God, Creator, Redeemer, and Holy Spirit go with each and every one of you this day, now, and forevermore.